Is it time for another giant leap? In 2080, NASA scientists believe we can and must send people to Jupiter and Saturn's moons. Space travel timeline of NASA. Exoplanet robotic missions and base camps on the moon in the late 2020s. A crewed mission to Mars is planned for the late 2030s. Robotic missions to Tau Ceti, 11.9 light-years away, in the 2030s. In the 2040s, robotic missions are launched to the TRAPPIST-1 system 40 light-years away. Robotic missions to distant stars in the 2050s. In the 2060s, a crewed mission will be launched to the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. Mission to Jupiter, probably Callisto because it is sufficiently removed from Jupiter's intense radiation fields, in the 2070s. Crewed missions to Saturn's moons, likely Titan and/or Enceladus, in the 2080s. We will conduct a crewed mission in 2250 to locate exoplanets such as Proxima Centauri, 4.2 light-years away. In 2300, a robotic mission is launched to TRAPPIST-1, a system 40 light-years away. A crewed mission to distant stars halfway to the Milky Way's center in the late 2400s. Off-world colonization is a fascinating prospect, but it also carries a dire warning about humanity becoming a multi-world species. Avoiding the Great Filter, a projected timeframe for human expansion off-world, is the title of the paper produced by NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory, JPL. Based on empirical data on space exploration and computing power during the first six decades of the space age, it constructs a model. Historically, that began with the launch of Sputnik 1 in 1957. It projects the earliest possible launch dates for human crewed missions to selected solar systems and interstellar destinations from cislunar space, not beyond the moon. Along with looking at what we've achieved so far, it uses Moore's Law, an indicator of technological developments. Moore's Law states that the number of transistors on a microchip doubles every 2 years, and the cost of computers is halved. In addition, microprocessors are growing exponentially. Is the universe welcoming us? Could it be hostile? We could stand here and wonder forever. Alternatively, we could turn away from this planet and explore the universe. Do we have the courage to see it through? Would we run home or would we stay? It's only a matter of time before we find out. Straight up, the edge of space is only 100 kilometers away. In our sights again as Artemis and SpaceX focus their efforts on moon bases. There are just over 400,000 kilometers between the Earth and the moon. Taking that giant leap is essential. According to NASA officials, astronauts are on course to live and work on the moon by the decade's end. Artemis 1 is the first step to long-term deep space exploration, says the head of Orion's lunar program. Before 2030, humans could live in habitats on the moon and operate rovers to support their activities. During this decade, we are most likely to see people living for extended periods depending on how long we remain on the surface. They will have habitats and rovers. It is planned to send people down to the surface where they will live on that surface and do science. The giant rocket, topped by the Orion spacecraft, launched on November 16, 2022 from Cape Canaveral in Florida, following delays due to technical difficulties and hurricanes. The Artemis 1 spacecraft carries three mannequins that will record stress and strain during the mission. As of now, the rocket is about 83,000 miles, 134,000 kilometers from the moon. This is the first step towards long-term deep space exploration for the United States and the world. Human spaceflight and deep space exploration are part of NASA's history on this particular day. But it is also part of the history of everyone who is a fan of human spaceflight and deep space exploration. After flying within 60 miles of the Moon, the spacecraft will continue for 40,000 miles before swinging back around and splashing down in the Pacific Ocean on December the 11th. During the 25-day mission, the spacecraft is expected to travel 1.3 million miles, the most significant distance ever flown by a spacecraft built for humans. Upon re-entering Earth's atmosphere, the spacecraft will travel at about 25,000 miles per hour, causing its heat shield to reach approximately 2,800 degrees centigrade, 5,000 degrees Fahrenheit. A splashdown is expected off San Diego's coast. In 2026, Artemis 3 may be the first human mission to land on the Moon since Apollo 17 in December 1972. NASA intends to put the first woman on the Moon on that mission, with a subsequent trip landing a person of color on the surface. After a successful Artemis mission, humans can go around the Moon and back in Artemis 2 and 3. Moving forward to Mars is possible. Astronauts will live and work at the Lunar Gateway, a space station named after the twin sister of Apollo, as part of the Artemis program. That's a bigger step, which will take 2 years, so learning beyond Earth orbit is important. There are spectacular yellow clouds on Venus that reflect the sunlight. That's why it's one of the brightest planets in our solar system. A sister planet to ours, as far as size and gravity are concerned, she is about the same as Earth. The clouds of Venus are dazzling, but they contain deadly sulfuric acid. Carbon dioxide chokes the planet's atmosphere. There is toxic air and unbearable pressure. Alarm bells are ringing that we shouldn't go, but people still believe we should go here instead of Mars. The temperature is approaching 500 degrees Celsius, and it's hot. There is a great deal of variation in temperature here. At night, temperatures are minus 170 degrees. By midday, it is 400 degrees. Scientists argue that a study of Earth's sister is worthwhile despite its hellish environment. Human exploration of Venus seems more appealing. In a flyby mission, astronauts would gaze down at the planet from the safety of their spacecraft instead of walking on its surface. However, there are some downsides as well. A group of experts advocate that our nearest neighbor should be the first target for a crewed mission to another planet, rather than Mars. It has the advantage, however, of being significantly closer, making a return trip to Venus doable in a year as opposed to a potentially 3-year round trip to Mars. Flybys would be scientifically valuable and could provide a valuable precursor to visiting Mars in the future. Venus has a challenging surface environment, so it gets a bad rap. It has practical arguments for incorporating a Venus flyby into a crewed Mars landing that NASA hopes to accomplish by late 2030. The current NASA paradigm is Moon to Mars. Some people advocate Moon to Venus, Venus to Mars. Venus is indeed in the wrong direction, but a slingshot around Venus, referred to as a gravity assist, could reduce travel time and fuel consumption on the way to Mars. NASA's goal of crewed flybys of Venus is a natural stepping stone toward achieving that goal. We must understand how to escape our cradle and move into the universe. As you'd be visiting another planet for the first time, it would have some cachet besides just going out into the middle of nowhere. You would learn how humans work in deep space without committing to a complete Mars mission. The scientific community is also paying more attention to Venus. Thousands of exoplanets have been discovered, and scientists want to know how and why Venus, a planet with similar mass and distance from the Sun, has infernal surface conditions. An article co-edited called Meeting with the Venus Goddess makes a case for the hypothetical mission, suggesting astronauts could observe Venus's active volcanoes, search for ancient life, and deploy teleoperated rovers, drones, and balloons. A vastly beautiful and mysterious world is expected on Venus. Only a few people, however, are convinced of this. A human mission would face considerable thermal challenges in a harsh environment. It is not a nice place to go, and it would be very challenging for a human to survive there. Undoubtedly, Mars is the most studied planet in the solar system. Are there any other things we don't know? Does it now just involve sending humans physically? Under Artemis, NASA plans to send the first woman and the first person of color to the moon's surface and establish sustainable exploration by the end of this decade. We will use what we learn on the moon to prepare for humanity's next giant leap, sending astronauts to Mars. Our mission will uncover new scientific discoveries and lay the groundwork for building a lunar economy. Initially, US companies will deliver scientific instruments and technology demonstrations to the lunar surface, followed by a spaceship called the Gateway that will support human and scientific missions around the moon, and a human lander that will carry astronauts to the surface. Space launch system rockets and Orion spacecraft will be the backbone for building the Gateway and transporting astronauts. Using the moon's unique perspective, NASA plans to look back at Earth, observe the Sun, and observe the universe. Our home planet, solar system, and the cosmos beyond can be explored through the moon's fascinating mysteries, many of which will advance our understanding of our home planet. The discovery of water on the moon and deposits of rare earth metals also hold promise for human and scientific exploration. NASA is developing and identifying scientific instruments and technology demonstrations for moon deliveries by US companies. Before sending astronauts to the moon, we can test new lander technologies using these deliveries. The Space Launch System, SLS, and Orion spacecraft are essential for NASA to explore the moon and beyond. With SLS, NASA can safely send humans into deep space. And with Orion, humans can remain alive hundreds of thousands of miles from home, where getting back to Earth can take days rather than hours. The Gateway, Orion, and SLS are the core of NASA's sustainable infrastructure for human exploration. On the first flight, the new spacecraft systems will be tested without crew. On the second flight, astronauts will be tested around the moon. Lunar Orbit Gateway Phase 1. Multiple trips down to the lunar surface will be possible with the Gateway throughout months-long crew expeditions. Additionally, the Gateway will operate autonomously as a deep space science outpost, even without a crew. An initial configuration will include a power and propulsion element and a crew cabin called the Habitation and Logistics Outpost, HALO. And be ready to receive logistics supplies. Eventually, the Gateway will become a way station for building refueling depots, servicing platforms, and processing moon samples for science and commerce. The Moon and Humans. With the long-term goal of providing global access to the moon and developing reusable landing systems, NASA is working with commercial companies to design and develop human landers. NASA's public-private partnerships are already advancing capabilities for human spaceflight in deep space while stimulating commercial activity, which is critical to its goal of sustainable lunar exploration. Increasingly prominent and capable landers will be developed for humans carrying more cargo and landing more precisely. Landers in the future will also carry sizable roving instrument kits to locate life-sustaining and mission-enabling resources on the Moon, as well as collect and return samples to the Gateway. A NASA concept also outlines how humans and robots will construct infrastructure for a long-term sustainable presence on the Moon. A Lunar Terrain Vehicle, or LTV, is being developed to transport crew members throughout the landing zone, a habitable mobility platform will enable crews to traverse the Moon for up to 45 days, and a surface habitat will house 4 crew members for short stays on the surface. Since missions to the Moon are about 1,000 times farther from Earth than missions to the International Space Station, they require systems that can operate reliably far from home, support human needs, and be light enough to launch. These technologies will become increasingly critical during the 34 million mile trip to Mars. Furthermore, NASA continues to work with companies to address the challenges of living in space, such as using existing resources and disposing of trash. Lunar and Mars exploration are intertwined. Using the Moon, we can test new tools, instruments, and equipment that could be used on Mars, such as human habitats, life support systems, and technologies and practices that could enable us to build self-sustaining outposts away from Earth. During the months spent on the Gateway, researchers will be able to observe how the human body responds to a deep space environment before committing to the years-long journey to Mars. These efforts will build on NASA's 60 years of exploration experience, including the 20 years of continuous human presence aboard the International Space Station. To achieve the ambitious exploration goals outlined in Space Policy Directive 1, the agency will move deeper into the solar system with its partners through the work underway to establish a permanent presence on the Moon, generating new markets and opportunities, both scientific and economical, and preparing humanity for Mars exploration. The planets, including ours, were created from rubble like this. We know the planets were born 4.5 billion years ago by dating the meteorites we find on Earth. These are the birth certificates of our solar system and planet. However, these rocks did not form a planet. They must have been stopped by something. The power of something. It is at least 1,000 times bigger than Earth. There is so much space inside it that you could fit all the other planets. Something this big will inevitably have a significant impact on its neighbors. Asteroids cannot form a planet due to their gravity. Jupiter is a beautiful planet. The view from a distance is breathtaking, but incredibly hostile up close. However, its moons are some of the most fascinating places in the solar system for research. NASA is considering a crewed mission to its moon, Callisto. The potential for life. Beyond Earth, Callisto is one of the most likely places for life to exist in our solar system. Galileo data and models created by scientists reveal that Callisto may have a salty ocean that interacts with a layer of rocks about 155 miles, 250 kilometers beneath its surface, which is critical for the formation of life. Another potential sign of life has been detected in the exosphere, oxygen. Callisto is widely considered the best place among Jupiter's moons for surface habitation, despite its unremarkable appearance at first glance. A strong magnetic field is not a characteristic this planet possesses, but rather its location. With a radius of 1.9 million kilometers, Callisto is the furthest of all Galilean moons from Jupiter, living 1.8 times farther away than Ganymede. Due to this simple increase in distance, the radiation experienced at the surface of this moon is only about 0.01 rem per day, or 12 times lower than what one would naturally experience on Earth. Humans could live on its surface with a sufficiently radiation-attenuating solid glass between humans and Callisto's host planet. Additionally, this moon is composed of around 40% water, making it relatively radiation-safe. In addition to being a valuable resource for potential inhabitants, it could also serve as a fuel source for further exploration. The future of human space travel lies in developing permanent habitats on other worlds, even if that future seems far off. In addition to the Moon and Mars, The Galilean moons, particularly Callisto, should also be considered for this effort. Humankind would not only achieve unprecedented achievements if these bodies were settled, but we would gain a deeper understanding of the universe if we pursued and realized this goal. Assumed to be created through a process similar to Earth's magnetic field, Ganymede's rotating molten core protects it from the constant tide of radiation emitted by its planet. With its diameter of 5,264 kilometers, more significant than Mercury, but with half the mass, Ganymede has slightly less gravity at its surface than Io and is the largest moon in the solar system. In addition, it is the only moon in our solar system with an observable magnetic field generated internally. In contrast to Earth's and Jupiter's magnetic fields, which are 65 and 417 microteslas respectively, this field is relatively weak at 0.72 microteslas. Although the moon's field provides some protection to its surface, the intensity of these belts results in a natural radiation exposure 700 times greater than that of Earth or Mars. Humans could not live on Ganymede the same way as we do on Earth, but they would also be more complementary to roam the surface than on Io, which is less shielded and more irradiated. In the future, one can imagine humans watching the tiny sunrise over the horizon, even if it is only for a short time, rather than being trapped in an exotic lava tube under the surface, which is not possible on Ganymede due to its theorized subsurface ocean and lack of geologic activity. As Jupiter appears 36 times larger than our moon from Earth, watching the polar auroras as the radiation belts break against the magnetic field of the moon would be an incredible sight, and one well worth the engineering effort. The Europa Clipper mission will explore Jupiter's icy moon. Europa, Jupiter's icy moon, has twice as much water as Earth's oceans. You might find the ingredients for life as we know it in Europa: water, energy, and organic molecules. Europa Clipper will launch in 2024 and arrive at Jupiter in 2030 to determine whether Europa and parallel worlds with global oceans are habitable. To thrive on Earth, three things are necessary: energy from a source such as sunlight, as a liquid solvent, water is a good choice, organic molecules formed from elements such as carbon. Europa, Jupiter's icy moon, may have these features. Europa has a thin ice shell about 20 kilometers, 12 miles thick, making it slightly smaller than Earth's moon. Under that lies a liquid saltwater ocean 150 kilometers or 100 miles deep, with twice as much water as Earth's oceans. No sunlight reaches Europa's ocean, but vents on the ocean floor may release heat from the moon's core. The deepest, darkest parts of Earth's oceans are home to similar vents, teeming with life. The planet's magnetic field traps high-energy particles from the sun and speeds them up into Europa's ice, possibly creating metabolism-driven molecules like methane, ammonia, and hydrogen. In 2024, NASA's Europa Clipper spacecraft will launch on a SpaceX Falcon Heavy rocket to determine whether Europa is habitable. In 2030, it will be the first mission dedicated to exploring an ocean world, a world with a global ocean besides Earth. Europa Clipper will help us understand the prospects for life on other ocean worlds in our solar system by determining whether Europa has the right conditions for life. Europa has long been a top priority for the scientific community. Tens of thousands of letters were sent to congressional representatives by members of the Planetary Society. Additionally, they sponsored events in Washington, D.C. to bring together scientists, politicians, and space advocates. The mission was also funded with the help of Congress. The mission was officially approved by NASA in 2015. Europa Clipper will spend most of its time outside the planet's intense radiation field, directly orbiting Jupiter instead of Europa. The spacecraft will dive through Jupiter's radiation periodically, fly by Europa for data collection, and then flee. As a result of this strategy, Europa Clipper will be able to study the Moon for years rather than days or months. Europa Clipper is 22 meters, 72 feet long, longer than a basketball court. Europa can be scanned from above by the spacecraft, and the tenuous atmosphere of the Moon can be directly sampled by the spacecraft. Europa's atmosphere can be sampled directly by the spacecraft, as well as ocean water and surface particles shot into space by Jupiter's radiation. A radar instrument will map Europa's ice, while a magnetometer will determine its depth and salinity. We will map the surface with color and infrared cameras and look for hotspots where the ocean may seep through the ice shell. To determine the composition of the surface and monitor any plumes spouting water into space, spectrometers will be used. The Europa Clipper will also scout potential landing sites for future space missions. NASA is considering a mission to spend a month on Europa's surface, collecting samples for analysis by organic materials detection instruments. The Saturnian moons Enceladus and Titan Explorer. The search for life on another planet in our solar system has become the most powerful theme in planetary exploration. Microbial life, the most likely form of life elsewhere in the solar system, is difficult to prove through a unified series of past, current, and planned missions to Mars. In addition to developing an orbiter to investigate the habitability of Europa, NASA is studying a follow-on lander to search directly for life on the planet. Three times in less than a decade, scientists have proposed a multiple flyby mission to explore Titan and Enceladus's habitability. European scientists have proposed the Explorer of Enceladus and Titan, E2T. In 2010, the journey to Enceladus, JET, and the Enceladus Life Finder, ELF, were two less ambitious proposals led by American scientists. Titan and Enceladus are two worlds unique in their geology, evolution, and habitability. A flyby mission such as E2T offers an unparalleled opportunity to explore two worlds in a relatively low-cost mission surpassing Cassini's feat. An analysis of the instruments proposed for the three proposed Saturn orbiters that would perform multiple flybys of Enceladus and Titan. The E2 team proposes a more ambitious mission than the previous teams. A study of Titan and Enceladus could provide valuable information about habitability and life on these planets. Under icy crusts on both worlds, the Cassini spacecraft, nearing the end of its 13-year exploration of Saturn, discovered salty water oceans. Titan also has a rich stew of organic molecules in its atmosphere, deposited on its surface and in its methane-ethane surface seas. The plumes of Enceladus's ocean jet samples into space conveniently. Cassini's instruments have detected organic molecules and trace minerals, suggesting hydrothermal water-rock interactions within the plumes that could provide a habitat for microbes. The three proposed missions to Enceladus and Titan would carry 2 to 3 instruments. In contrast, NASA plans to explore the habitability of Europa, another ocean world. Several of the instruments on the Europa mission will produce floods of data that will require a high-powered communication system to return them to Earth. The prior exploration history of Europa and Saturn's moons is a critical difference. Galileo, a spacecraft built in the 1970s with a crippled communication system, explored Europa. NASA's new Europa mission must conduct its own comprehensive global study of this planet. Enceladus and Titan were first investigated by the highly capable Cassini spacecraft built in the 1990s. Therefore, the next mission to these moons can focus on a few specific questions that 2 to 3 instruments can answer. It is proposed that 2 instruments on the E2T spacecraft will measure the atmosphere's composition in situ. Enceladus's plumes can be flown through by spacecraft, and the ocean's contents can be tasted. The spacecraft can sample the atmosphere's chemistry at Titan by carrying complex organic molecules to the outermost fringes of the atmosphere. Mass spectrometers on the E2T spacecraft would sample material during each passage and determine its composition by weighing its constituent molecules. It is possible to determine the composition of the original material by interpreting the distribution of the weights of the different molecules. In the plumes of Enceladus, the Enceladus Icy Jet Analyzer will determine the composition of ice, salt, and dust particles using the spacecraft's ion and neutral gas mass spectrometer. It will measure the nature of organic chemicals, the pattern of carbon isotopes, the relative abundances of noble gases, and search for amino acids and abnormal isotope ratios in organic molecules. Both of these instruments were carried by the Cassini spacecraft. NASA's Europa mission would carry similar instruments to E2Ts, and Europe's JUICE mission to Jupiter and its moon Ganymede will use similar instruments to E2Ts. However, the E2T instruments would have 40 to 50 times better resolution, the ability to distinguish similar molecules, and sensitivity, the ability to measure minute amounts of a substance. Two mass spectrometers would address several critical questions from the E2T team. Do the materials in the plume on Enceladus originate from its formation or current geological or biological processes? What does the composition reveal about the liquid reservoir, presently thought to be a global ocean beneath an icy cap, and its potential as a habitat for life? What are the sources of Titan's volatiles, and how have they been processed? Does the current atmosphere appear to be refreshed by material reaching the surface from deep oceans based on the composition of the atmosphere? E2T's third instrument would image Titan's surface and Enceladus's plumes, the so-called tiger stripes, in near and shortwave infrared. TIGER stands for Titan Imaging and Geology, Enceladus Reconnaissance Camera. Titan is perpetually shrouded in atmospheric haze, hiding its surface from cameras that can detect most wavelengths. As a result of spectral windows at 1.3, 2, and 5 microns, a camera can image the surface at several times better resolution than the similar instrument on Cassini, and at a higher resolution than Cassini's radar. Images returned by the camera will answer several key questions. How do sediments produced and transported by fluvial and aeolian processes differ? What changes have been caused by the rivers and seas of liquid methane and ethane? In what ways do the three colors of the spectral bands reveal the surface composition? The JET proposal, however, would have imaged Titan's surface at several times Cassini's resolution and flown through its plumes at different altitudes. An analysis of the instruments proposed for the three proposed Saturn orbiters that would perform multiple flybys of Enceladus and Titan. E2T proposes a more ambitious mission than previous teams. Despite Titan and Enceladus's apparent potential for further exploration, what is surprising about E2T and its predecessors is that they were put forward for low-cost missions flown by the European Space Agency, ESA, and NASA. Both ESA and NASA have missions that are similarly priced and low cost. The Europeans can propose missions for planetary science, astrophysics, or heliophysics under this medium-class mission program. The Discovery program is a program dedicated to exploring the solar system for Americans. The costs directly managed by the mission's principal investigator is capped at 550 million euros for ESA and $450 million for NASA under these programs. Euros and dollars have similar purchasing power in Europe and the United States. ESA missions must cover the cost of the spacecraft, mission operations and launch, but not the cost of instruments, science teams or data analysis, which are separately covered by individual nations. The NASA cap covers the spacecraft, instruments, and science team, except those contributed by foreign nations, but not launch or mission operations, which are paid separately. Nevertheless, the E2T proposal incorporates the lessons learned from those earlier proposals, and scientists from those earlier efforts are on the E2T team. We need to know how the E2 team proposes to fit within the budget cap. In the presentation provided to me by Dr. Mitri, several figures have been removed because they would reveal too much about the proposal. However, the team has provided enough information about the mission to reveal some essential strategies. A proposal's competitive edge depends heavily on this information. According to the description above, the E2T would have limited, focused science goals, making it a simple, low-cost spacecraft. Over 3.5 years, the spacecraft will orbit Saturn with 6 Enceladus flybys and 17 Titan flybys. Each flyby's data would be returned to Earth leisurely in the weeks between encounters. The lower peak data return rate ripples through the spacecraft's design, lowering mission costs. In addition to reducing costs, having only 3 instruments and significant time between encounters also reduces the number of mission controllers required. To explore Enceladus and Titan, the E2T team needs to describe its planned orbits around Saturn. Flights through Enceladus's plumes would have been possible through a series of orbits. The similar JET proposal, however, would have allowed imaging of different hemispheres of Titan using multiple orbits. E2T proposes to launch with another spacecraft, such as a communication satellite, into a geostationary transfer orbit. The spacecraft can propel itself out of Earth's orbit and reach Saturn in just 6 years by using solar electric propulsion. The JET mission would have taken 7 to 8.5 years, while the ELF mission would have taken 10 years. Once at Saturn, the spacecraft would use chemical propulsion to enter orbit and meet Saturn. It is estimated that splitting the launch cost would save the E2 €60 million, or enough to pay for most mission operations on the way to Saturn. Using solar power instead of plutonium-powered radioisotope generators would result in further cost savings. The choice is partially due to ESA's lack of radioisotope generator technology, and NASA is prohibited from providing one to alien spacecraft by law. At Saturn, the spacecraft can generate 620 watts of power using massive solar arrays of 160 square meters, compared to 70 square meters for Juno. A portion of this power will heat the spacecraft and its instruments. About half of Juno's power is reserved for this, but the E2T mission would have ample power to spare. Solar arrays on the E2T spacecraft would gather enough sunlight to produce electricity at Saturn. As a result of these large solar arrays, the spacecraft can return data from mapping Titan's surface. By comparison, the ELF mission would have had smaller solar arrays and would not have been able to return imaging data. The JET mission would have used radioisotope generators to generate enough power to map Titan and excess heat. E2T also has another advantage over its predecessors. The team will have almost 5 years to refine the design if the mission is selected by ESA. As a result, there will be more time to acceptably tune cost savings and take advantage of spacecraft technology advances that will reduce costs. NASA's Discovery missions must be ready for implementation immediately after selection. The proposing teams must have resolved all key design issues before submitting their proposal. I am encouraged by the fact that the community of scientists interested in exploring Titan and Enceladus continues to put forward similar, if refined, proposals. Preparing for these mission competitions takes a lot of time and money. They would only keep coming back if the budget math was close. Also, in NASA's Discovery program, teams often propose missions several times, incorporating the lessons learned each time their proposals are rejected. In addition to two previous proposals, the E2T team builds on those experiences. A rejection of the E2T proposal may lead to another lesson within the Discovery program. On its way to return samples from the asteroid Bennu, OSIRIS-REx twice failed to pitch its ideas to Discovery. Finally, they succeeded with NASA's New Frontiers program, which allowed PI expenses of approximately $800 million. NASA is seeking proposals for missions to Titan and Enceladus, along with missions to five other solar system destinations, for its fourth New Frontiers mission. There will be at least one mission similar to E2T, perhaps with more instruments. Teams may also use the additional funding to propose a sample return from Enceladus's plumes or a Titan lander. A Titan Lake lander was also proposed for the Discovery program at the time of the JET proposal. NASA will announce its list of finalists in November, while ESA will announce its list in June. An ESA mission to Titan and Enceladus would launch around 2030, while a NASA mission would launch around 2025. By the mid-2030s, fans of these two worlds are likely to see spacecraft arrive at Saturn due to these two competitions. Researchers say Uranus's moons may harbor underground oceans that could support alien life. Subsurface oceans may be similar to those on Jupiter's moon Europa, a possible candidate for alien life. The search for habitable worlds that could have hosted alien life examines whether Uranus's moons could have oceans hidden beneath their surface. Miranda, Ariel, Umbriel, Titania, and Oberon, the five largest moons of Uranus, have similarities with Europa and Enceladus, the moons of Jupiter and Saturn. Moons like these display cryovolcanism, which occurs when liquids and vapors trapped under their surfaces escape and become frozen when they hit low external temperatures. According to images from Voyager 2 in 1986, the moons appear to have fresh, uncrated material, ridges, valleys, and folds. There is a big question. Where in the solar system are habitable environments? Benjamin Weiss, a planetary scientist at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, said, "Scientists calculated Uranus's magnetic field strength and how that would affect oceans under its moon's surfaces. The same technique NASA used to confirm Europa's ocean and another ocean on Jupiter's moon Callisto." A moon could generate electricity if it could detect Uranus's magnetic field and also experiences differences in its strength and detection due to its movement through the field. It can be conducted if liquid water is a little salty, like ocean water on Earth. This current then generates its own magnetic field, known as an induced magnetic field, which is detectable by spacecraft, in contrast to Uranus's field. Miranda's moon has the strongest magnetic field, 300 nanoteslas, while Oberon has the weakest, with 3 nanoteslas. Thus, scientists predict that subsurface oceans on Miranda, Ariel, Umbriel, and Titania all could be measured, although Oberon's is probably too weak to notice, being on the edge of what's currently detectable. Uranus's field is non-spin symmetric, unlike Saturn's, and it rotates. David Stevenson, a planetary scientist at the California Institute of Technology, said the technique should work. Due to the thicker icy shell of Uranus's moons, the oceans are likely to be deeper than those of Jupiter's moons, but this might make them easier to detect. The ability to get close enough to one or more satellites to see this is unlikely to be a feature of a mission to Uranus that arrives before 2042. Is NASA going to Sedna? In 2003, Sedna was discovered to be the farthest object in the solar system from the Sun. Scientists say the Pluto-killing planet that orbits our Sun every 11,408 years is almost within range. The planet orbits the Sun every 11,400 years, is 3 times further out than Neptune, takes 40 Earth days to rotate, and is 3 times farther out than Neptune. Recent research suggests we should launch a mission to this strange and distant trans-Neptunian object in 2029 or 2034. What is the reason for our imminent visit to Sedna? Now is the time to act. In its massive 11,400-year orbit, Sedna moves to its perihelion, the closest point to the Sun, during its highly eccentric and elongated orbit. In 2073-74, it will reach that point. Unfortunately, it will only reach 74 AU from the Sun. To put that into perspective, a solar system distance is measured in AU, the distance from Earth to the Sun. The eighth planet, Neptune, is located 30 AU from the Sun, on average. Sedna is very far away. Even at its closest distance and farthest, it is a whopping 937 AU away. Sedna's upcoming perihelion offers a rare chance to study a proper deep space object that spends much of its time in the outer reaches of our solar system, and perhaps even in the Oort cloud. Small icy bodies and a potential comet live in the Oort cloud, a vast sphere around the solar system. Sedna is a long way away, however. Should we launch by a specific date? According to analysis of mission opportunities to Sedna in 2029-2034, a preprint paper also submitted to Advances in Space Research, a spacecraft must begin its journey between 2029 and 2034. Vladislav Zubkov of the Space Research Institute of the Russian Academy of Sciences says it would be possible to send a direct flight to Sedna once a year, but the problem is speed. To reach Sedna during human life, a spacecraft must go as fast as possible while still going slowly as it approaches the planet. A direct flight or an orbital flight would be practically impossible, so a flyby is the only option. With gravity assists from Venus, Earth, and Jupiter, a flight in 2029 could be completed in 20 years, but probably more like 30 years. As with New Horizons' flyby of Pluto in 2015, the latter would offer the advantage of a slower flyby and the chance to gather more scientific data. The spacecraft could also fly by the main belt asteroid 20, Massalia, if it leaves by 2029, or 16, Psyche, if it leaves by 2034, after the flyby of Sedna. How does Sedna behave? Deep space exploration is exciting because of Sedna. The red layer indicates that it has organic hydrocarbon compounds called tholins, which may have been the building blocks of life in the early solar system. Ice covers the surface of Sedna. Sedna may have an ocean beneath its surface. When it's close to perihelion, as it is now, it has a thin atmosphere. Sedna was the most distant object ever discovered in the solar system when it was discovered by American astronomer Michael Brown in 2003. Eventually, Pluto's full planet status was removed by the International Astronomical Union after a series of distant objects were discovered, including Haumea, Makemake, and Eris. Alternatively, about 20 different objects could have been called planets. The controversy over Pluto's demotion and the bizarre manner in which it was done by vote is why the term worlds has come to be used for anything other than the now 8 planets. We have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to visit Sedna, no matter its nomenclature. A Ceres orbiter and a giant telescope are being considered by the Chinese Academy of Sciences to hunt for dark matter clues. The Chinese Academy of Sciences, CAS, is evaluating more than 20 candidates for funding under the Strategic Priorities Programme on Space Science, SPP, also known as the New Horizon Programme. In the second half of 2022, the National Space Science Centre, NSSC, in Beijing will organise a panel of experts to review this pre-Phase A candidate and provide project priority recommendations. In the coming decade, the selected missions could be further studied and possibly developed into missions. Several mission proposals are listed in a paper on the progress of the third round of SPP mission selection published in the Chinese Journal of Space Science. Among them are the Very Large Area Gamma Ray Space Telescope, VLAST, a space weather program, a Ceres exploration program, and a gravity experimental satellite. There are proposals on space astronomy and astrophysics, exoplanets, heliophysics, planetary science, earth science, space biology, and fundamental physics. Most missions are unknown, but Ceres and VLAST appear to be more well-defined. Ceres' proposals would include an orbiter with a ground-penetrating radar as a primary payload, focusing on the origin of Ceres and its underground ocean and volcanic geological activities. NASA's Dawn mission is the only spacecraft to visit Ceres, launched in 2007 under the Discovery Program. The Ocean World Ceres may have ongoing geological activity and could be further assessed for habitability. As a result of the mission, we may gain new insights into Ceres and, by extension, ocean worlds and volatiles throughout the solar system. The search for a new home for humanity beyond Earth's orbit is more urgent than ever for space agencies and billionaires. With its 24-hour day-night cycle, CO2-rich atmosphere, and relative proximity to Earth, Mars is an obvious candidate. However, a school of spacefaring thought suggests colonizing another planet, any planet, would be more trouble than it would be worth. According to a paper published on January the 6th to the preprint database ARXIV, ditch the red planet and build a giant floating habitat around Ceres instead. In the paper, which hasn't yet been peer-reviewed, astrophysicist Pekka Janhunen of the Finnish Meteorological Institute in Helsinki describes his vision of a mega-satellite of thousands of cylindrical spacecraft all linked inside a disc-shaped frame that orbits Ceres, the largest object in the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. According to Janhunen, these cylindrical habitats could accommodate 50,000 people, support an artificial atmosphere, and generate an Earth-like gravity through centrifugal force. The O'Neill cylinder is a general idea that was first proposed in the 1970s. What makes Ceres so unique? Janhunen wrote that its average distance from Earth is comparable to Mars, making travel relatively easy. But the dwarf planet also has significant elemental advantages. Earth's atmosphere is roughly 79% nitrogen, so Ceres is rich in nitrogen, which would be crucial for building the atmosphere for the orbiting settlement. Instead of building a colony on the surface of the small world, Ceres has a radius roughly 1/13th of Earth, settlers could use space elevators to move raw materials directly up to their orbiting habitats. Furthermore, the orbital lifestyle would also address one of Janhunen's main concerns about the idea of a Martian surface colony, the health effects of low gravity. Because of the too low Martian gravity, Janhunen worries that children would not develop into healthy adults, in terms of muscles and bones. To provide Earth-like gravity and an interconnected world, I search for an alternative. According to an outside researcher, Janhunen's proposal has its own caveats that could hinder a thriving Ceres colony. It's important not to forget Tau Ceti. Alpha Centauri stars are at least as enjoyable as the second closest, properly sun-like star. Tau Ceti, A G-class star about 78% the mass of our Sun, and perhaps only a billion years older, has long been a favorite source for science fiction. However, it has received far less attention than it deserves from hungry exoplanetary scientists, astrobiologists, and wannabe interstellar explorers. The Tau Ceti Sun is about 2.8 times farther from us than Proxima Centauri b, the closest planet to a star. Astronomers have claimed to have detected planets orbiting Tau Ceti based on Doppler measurements of the stellar wobble since 2012. Data from the HARP spectrometer at the European Southern Observatory's La Silla site in Chile and measurements from the high-res instrument at the Keck Observatory in Hawaii have been analyzed in recent years to support the notion of four planets orbiting Tau Ceti about the size of Earth. Planetary candidates range from 1.7 times the mass of Earth to perhaps four times as massive. Two of these worlds, however, lie near the boundaries of the nominal liquid water orbital zone in the system, with orbital radii ranging from 0.13 to 1.3 AU. In addition to pushing the limits of Doppler or radial velocity, this analysis relies on some tricky noise removal to extract delicate signals. Future work could confirm these worlds, elevating Tau Ceti to another must-have exoplanet. Tau Ceti is surrounded by much more interplanetary dust than our solar system, as much as 10 times more. A region of this material covers an orbital distance of roughly 10 AU to 55 AU. As a result, the system may be more similar to our solar system's Kuiper Belt and has a higher rate of collisions and planetary impacts. Tau Ceti has an abundance of heavy elements, about 28% of that of the Sun. According to observations of other dusty debris disks around nearby stars, our solar system may have a narrower belt of outer material. Our system may be flawed by asteroid and comet impacts. Tau Ceti is one of the most intriguing places in the universe. There are exciting planets there, but it's also older and different in some fundamental ways that could impact the possibility of life emerging or sustaining there. Tau Ceti might be worth a shot if interstellar probes are launched, like those proposed by Breakthrough Starshot. It would take 20 years to get to Proxima Centauri and 60 years to reach Tau Ceti, but it would be well worth the wait. TRAPPIST-1, one of seven planets orbiting a minor star, may be able to support life as we know it on Earth, according to new climate models. At 39 light-years from Earth, TRAPPIST-1 is an excellent M-dwarf star with about 9% of Earth's Sun's mass and 12% of its radius. At least seven rocky planets the size of Earth or smaller are believed to exist around this ultra-cool star. Researchers from the University of Washington simulated environmental states for each planet in the TRAPPIST-1 system, using terrestrial climate and photochemistry models. Based on the models, all seven exoplanets likely developed like Venus, meaning any oceans or water would have evaporated early in the system's formation. According to these models, TRAPPIST-1's seven planets would have dense, uninhabitable atmospheres. However, one world, TRAPPIST-1e, may have liquid water on its surface, and therefore be capable of supporting Earth-like life. Modeling unfamiliar atmospheres is not just about assuming that what we see in our solar system will look the same around another star. To demonstrate how these different atmospheres might look, this research was conducted. A planet's habitable zone is the distance from a star at which it's warm enough to have liquid water on its surface and potentially support life as we know it on Earth. TRAPPIST-1e is located in that habitable zone. In addition to having a lot of oxygen, this planet may also have a lot of carbon dioxide. According to the statement, the hydrogen and oxygen molecules split when the water evaporates from a planet's surface and is zapped by a star's ultraviolet emissions. While hydrogen can leave the atmosphere despite the planet's gravity, oxygen will remain. In the statement, researchers said TRAPPIST-1e could have a thick oxygen atmosphere formed through processes never seen before. This could be possible if these planets initially had more water than Earth, Venus, or Mars. It might have a climate similar to Earth if TRAPPIST-1e did not lose all its water during this phase. The habitable zone is also home to two other exoplanets in the TRAPPIST-1 system. TRAPPIST-1h orbits just past the outer edge of this Goldilocks-like region, while TRAPPIST-1d rides the inner edge. In particular, this sequence of planets shows how planets evolved around a very different star from our own, with a different spectrum of light coming from it. It is essential to consider how the chemical composition of the atmosphere affects the climate of M-dwarf stars. The spectral signatures of gases in the star's atmosphere can be derived from models of its radiation and chemistry. In 2021, the James Webb Space Telescope, which is expected to launch in 2019, will be able to better predict where to look for these gases in the atmospheres of exoplanets. The observed bumps and wiggles in the spectra will allow astronomers to infer the presence of specific gases, and compare that to our own observations to learn about the planet's composition, environment, and evolutionary history. TRAPPIST-1e may be habitable, but TRAPPIST-1b, the closest planet to the star, may be too hot even for sulfuric acid clouds to form. TRAPPIST-1c and 1d receive slightly more energy from their star than Venus and Earth, so their atmospheres are dense and uninhabitable. According to the statement, TRAPPIST-1f, g, and h may also be frozen worlds, depending on how much water formed on them during their evolution. A terrestrial planet's evolution determines whether or not it can be habitable, as well as our ability to interpret possible signs of life, said Victoria Meadows, co-author and UW professor of astronomy. The results of this study suggest that we may soon be able to detect signs of these processes on alien worlds.